writing here, oral arguments in the case of Sable House, Kevin Ecker. Each party will have 15 minutes in which to argue the case. The appellate may reserve for 5 minutes for rebuttal if you call it, and you should remain that time. Let me know when you come up to the podium. I'm keeping track of the clock and we'll keep you apprised of the passage of time. We are being visually and audibly recorded to be posted online, so please try to remain behind the podium as much as possible. We have read your briefs and we're ready to proceed with you.
Thank you, Your Honor. May it please the court, I'd like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal.
Thank you.
The main issue I came here to talk about, of course, any topic the court wishes me to go on and address, but was the waiver issue to assign error number one, because I don't see how that was waived. This is the joinder issue, the improper severance issue. And when the state filed a motion to join, counsel filed a written objection. Participated in the hearing to opposed it at a hearing. During opening statements, when the state started, he made another objection. And between the time the evidence closed and the case went to the jury, he once more renewed all his motions. And when he said, "I renew all my motions," and he specifically said, all my motions, the court didn't say, what are you talking about? The state didn't say, what are you talking about? That would have been the time to tell him, that's not enough, but he did make the objection there. Now, the state did point to one case where this court found that a general statement that wasn't clear about what counsel was objecting to, that it made more sense to say counsel was just renewing the criminal Rule 29 motion that he had just made previously. But that's not what here, that's not what happened here. This counsel specifically said, all my motions. And even if it somehow does have to be renewed after the close of argument, after closing arguments, it didn't say immediately after. It says just, the state says after. Well, this was after, and it was before it went to the jury. And I also have a belt and suspenders argument. There's nothing in Criminal Rule 13 or 14 that says this motion has to be renewed. I pointed this court to several other states that have rules that say you have to renew this motion. Well, Ohio doesn't have that provision in there. And absent some reason to say that they shouldn't, that it shouldn't apply, that the pretrial motion that was done at an evidentiary hearing shouldn't be sufficient for the court to make, for the court to proceed. The pretrial motion should have been enough by itself. So I hope the court doesn't need to get there by finding the objection was sufficient.
Of course, the show has to be prejudice, correct?
Correct. And there were several problems. This was two distinct incidents, two very different incidents with very different levels of proofing. One was the death of a supposed customer of Mr. Ecker, and the other one was more of the run-of-the-mill drug possession trafficking cases. And the possession trafficking was not clear evidence. It was under a woman's underwear. In a place where there was a woman when they came in after. Also, they spent a lot of time, the prosecutor spent a lot of time discussing the life and death issues of fentanyl, of the problem, that all came in simply to prove and only to prove the manslaughter charge, which has absolutely no bearing on the possession and trafficking, the second charge. And that was a lot of inflammatory evidence that was objected to. But it came in because the state was able to bring it in to show the risks of fentanyl. It also brought in some other evidence of him saying very derogatory comments about the victim in the first case, referring to her as a junkie B word, and then he talked about there's a jail phone call where he talked about a sex act that he exchanged drugs for with her. It was, and none of that would have been admissible as to the second case as well. Also then those calls from jail that came in that would not have been relevant to the second case whatsoever, but they came in and that also showed the jury, yes, he was in jail. Normally you're not supposed to let the defendant, the jury know that he was in, that he had served time for something, that he'd been in trouble for something else. And even he was searched pursuant to, with his post-release control parole officer for the second event. They were able to somewhat mitigate that, but they didn't believe, instead of saying that he was his parole officer, that he was a state officer on the fugitive task force. Well, he's on the fugitive task force. What does that mean? It means Mr. Ecker has to have had a prior offense. And the court doesn't have any other questions with that. I'll just move briefly to what I said about the wire issue and assignment number, error number two, the state's response. They got into the state over objection, got into evidence that my client said he would refuse to wear a waiver. The state, and I know this wasn't, this court is speaking with two lawyers who didn't write the original merit briefs in this case. They did write the reply brief, but and the state's response was that, well, he brought up the issue. Well, kind of he brought up the issue. He brought up the issue with the officer. He didn't bring it up at trial. He said to the officer, he told the officer, no, I'm not. He brought that up to the officer. That's not opening the door. So there is no waiver or forfeiture or any sort of invited error issue. That's just an evidentiary issue. And unless the court has any other questions, I'll cede the podium to my...
As to that issue, it's my understanding the trial counsel did make an objection, correct?
Correct.
Was the objection just denied flat out, or was there some basis for the denial?
I don't remember. I just remember saying they objected to that, and counsel's up. I'll see if I can find that part of the brief.
We'll find out eventually.
Okay.
I just wondered if you knew
it. Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you.
Thank you. May it please the court, good morning. I'm Jacquinette Corgan on behalf of the appellee, the state of Ohio, this morning to urge this court to affirm the convictions of Mr. Ecker in this case. Getting first of all to the issue of joinder, which is the appellant's first assignment of error, the state submits that the joinder of these two cases from 2015 and 2016 was indeed proper and was not did not constitute an abuse of discretion on the trial court's part, because the evidence, in light of all the evidence that came in the trial, the evidence in this case was distinct enough and was simple and direct enough to allow the jury to segregate the proof of each offense in the minds of the jurors and to keep the proof of one case from proving the second case. Because one of the problems with impermissible joinders, the thing that one wants to prevent is from having two relatively weak cases being tried together and the weak cases strengthen each other to the point where you wind up with a conviction that if the cases had been tried separately would not have been strong enough to have a sufficient case. That's not the case here. Each of these cases had its own evidence, had its own time frame, had its own proof. And in fact, the proof that was offered for each case was different enough that it was direct and simple enough for the jury to follow and to understand that the evidence that came in that the state presented to prove the manslaughter charge, to prove the corrupting another with drugs, and to prove the trafficking case from 2015 in connection with Ms. Kendra Hall's death was separate and distinct from the 2016 case where officers arrive at Mr. Ecker's house because of the parole search and they find drugs in a lady's boot. Okay. The proofs of each were separate and distinct enough, not just in time frame, but in purpose as well.
Did the court address the potential inflammatory nature of the death of a young woman in the one case in deciding this joinder issue?
I don't recall that being in the court's journal entry.
Should it consider that?
I don't recall that any kind of potential inflammatory nature of the fact of Ms. Canada Holmes' death was even raised in the written motions.
Where does the issue of prejudice to the defendant by consolidating the two cases fit into the weighing test?
The prejudice to the defendant.
I mean, obviously, any evidence is going to be prejudicial. Not any, but
right.
Often it can be. But when is it too much?
Well, it's never just mere prejudice. It has to be unfairly prejudicial. To decide that it is prejudicial, the court has to analyze whether evidence of the other of each crime would be admissible for the other, even if the counts were severed, and if not, whether the evidence of each crime is simple and distinct. The burden is on the defendant to show, of course, that his rights have been unfairly prejudiced, and at the time that he moved to sever the offenses, he provided enough information to the trial court that the trial court could weigh the considerations favoring joinder versus the defendant's right to a fair trial.
I guess that's what my concern was with my question, so thank you for sort of narrowing it, Judge Callahan. For instance, I'm not so certain the state could have gotten into the 200 overdose deaths from fentanyl, 140, you know, the numbers that are associated with heroin overdoses, if the cases were separated. I mean, obviously they could have been in the case of the young woman who overdosed, but that evidence wouldn't have been admissible in the other case, would it?
No, and that's not actually, I don't think that's actually the test as to whether it would be admissible. In this context.
Well, doesn't that create prejudice, I guess is what I'm saying.
Right. I think in this context, the evidence of the number of overdose deaths, I think the jury could figure out very easily that only went to the manslaughter case, because one of the elements that the state had to prove was that this was that death from an overdose could be a foreseeable consequence of providing opiates to someone, but that person's death could be a foreseeable result, you know, a proximate result.
So it's easily separable.
Correct.
Right. Okay.
Exactly. It's easily separated out. And it really, that's something that I think the jury understood to be only relevant to the manslaughter and corrupting another with drugs. And so
there was a fentanyl charge in the 2016 case, though.
That's correct. And that's the only drug in common as far as the trafficking cases. That's the only drug in common with the 2015 and 2016 cases. The 2016 case also involved cocaine and methamphetamine. So we were just talking about supplying fentanyl to this particular victim who then overdosed as a proximate result of that. But with the court's permission, I did want to get into the idea of the question about whether Mr. Ecker would be willing to wear a wire, whether that was unfairly prejudicial to him, such as to constitute other acts evidence. And the state submits that it was not, because it's not prejudicial. For it to be impermissible other acts evidence, it has to be of such a nature as to arouse the jury's emotions rather than their intellect and evoke a sense of horror or to appeal to the jury's instinct to punish. Saying, I don't want to wear a wire is not that kind of evidence. So the state submits that didn't constitute impermissible other acts evidence. And again, we're getting into the idea of you know, all the evidence that each side presents is prejudicial to the other side. It's not whether it's prejudicial, but whether it's unfairly prejudicial to the defendant in this case. And the state submits it was not. Just briefly, if the court has no further questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And start with answering Judge Callahan's question from that I ended the last main part with. On page 1134 of the transcript, the court just said objection is overruled. But I was also on, starting with the wire, part of the point here is that there is zero probative value to that. There's no reason to get it in except to show that he was being obstructionist, that he wasn't cooperating with law enforcement. There is absolutely no reason to get it in other than to inflame the jury. And I think that point has a nice segue into the severance issue, because my friend on the other side was talking about how unfair prejudice evidence, it's evidence that appeals to emotions only. Well, looking at the second offense, appealing to emotions are things such as talking about all the deaths that are caused on this, that has no result to what, that has absolutely no impact on whether my client actually had fentanyl at that time. All the names he called, the names of the very, very nasty ways in which he spoke about the victim in the first case, the fact that he's calling from jails, and the idea of unfair prejudice assumes that jurors are not computers, they're not automatons, they're not robots, they have emotions, and when you start piling on what would be impermissible other acts evidence, and it's impermissible other acts evidence for a reason, it starts to make the trial unfair. And these cases are probably the worst possible cases to bring together, because they have a small logical connection, a very small logical connection, but it's a gigantic emotional connection. The emotional connection in one case could lead, is unfair in the other. The emotional arguments that the state was allowed to get in and for the fentanyl death were purely appeals to emotion when it came to the second case, and to expect jurors to listen to lots and lots of evidence about how bad my client was, how poorly he treated this woman, how bad fentanyl is, how many lives it's disrupting, that was prejudicial when it came to the second offense. Maybe that's relevant when it comes to sentencing. The judge considered that as sentencing, but it's not relevant at the guilt or innocence stage. And I ask this court to reverse his convictions and send it back and give him the two trials so you can have juries that will look at each set of evidence independently and fairly weigh his guilt or innocence. Thank you.
Thank you both for your presentations today. The court will take the matter under advisement, issue a written decision, which will be mailed to both sides as well as posted to our website.